Good evening and welcome to your Thursday, April 4, 2024 edition of the Evening News. I am Jemima Holmes. Thank you for joining us. Let's take a look at some of the lead stories tonight. "We are not naive, we are very watchful of what is happening," says President Ali on Venezuela's latest act of aggression. "Over 5,000 pounds of cocaine seized in major bust off Guyana's coast, 4 arrested." As wildfires rage on, families forced to evacuate, emergency response activated. Construction of first 100 homes begins at Silica City, and make Guyana your stopover choice for long-haul flights, EGIL urges airlines. Now for the news in detail. We begin tonight's newscast by telling you that 4 persons have been arrested in connection with a massive drug bust that was recently made off Guyana's coast. The bust was made on March 21 by the U.S. Drug Enforcement Agency, Georgetown Country Office, in collaboration with the Joint Interagency Task Force South, Guyana Customs Anti-Narcotics Unit, and the United States Coast Guard. The joint operation resulted in the seizure of a self-propelled semi-submersible vessel, which was situated approximately 150 miles off the coast of Guyana. It was carrying 2,370 kilograms of cocaine, equivalent to over 5,000 pounds. The U.S. Navy's guided missile cruiser USS Leyte Gulf interdicted the vessel, resulting in the arrest of 4 individuals and seizure of the cocaine. This landmark seizure will be prosecuted in the United States. Vanu Manikchan joins us now to report that Guyana has put the Venezuelan government and the international community on notice that it will not allow any part of its sovereign territory to be annexed, seized, or occupied by any neighboring country. This latest condemnation of Venezuela's action comes after President Nicolas Maduro enacted laws to establish Guyana's Essequibo region as a state within Venezuela.
On Wednesday, President Nicolas Maduro promulgated the Organic Law for the Defense of Guyana Essequibo. Maduro said this organic law will guarantee that the December 3, 2023 referendum will be fully implemented in defense of Venezuela and its territory. However, in a statement on Thursday from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation, the Guyana government said this attempt by Venezuela to annex more than 2/3 of Guyana's sovereign territory, the Essequibo, is an egregious violation of the international law enshrined in the United Nations Charter and the Charter of the Organization of American States. This unlawful act calls into question Venezuela's obligation to abide by the letter and spirit of the Joint Declaration of Argyle for Dialogue and Peace between Guyana and Venezuela, agreed to on December 14, 2023 in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Nevertheless, the Guyana government has since vowed to reject Venezuela's attempt to annex its sovereign territory. It said, quote, "The government of the Cooperative Republic of Guyana wishes to put on notice the government of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela, the governments of the Caribbean Community and the Latin America and Caribbean Community of Nations, as well as the Secretary General of the United Nations and the Secretary General of the Organization of American States, that it will not countenance the annexation, seizure, or occupation of any part of its sovereign territory. Guyana has always stood by the principles of the United Nations Charter, the rule of law, and the peaceful settlement of disputes," end quote. The missive from Georgetown further noted that the proper forum for Venezuela to contest title to Essequibo is through the International Court of Justice, where Guyana has gone to obtain a final and binding ruling on the validity of the 1899 arbitral award that settled the land boundary between the two countries. However, Maduro on Wednesday declared that Venezuela does not and will never recognize the arbitral award, and also reiterated the Spanish-speaking nation's non-recognition of the ICJ. He also criticized President Dr. Irfan Ali as a puppet of the United States government, the British government, and the US oil giant ExxonMobil, which is currently engaged in oil production activities in Guyana's exclusive economic zone off the Essequibo coast. These remarks about President Ali were not unnoticed by the Guyanese government, which labeled them as offensive and undignified. According to the missive, it is unfortunate that the commitment made at Argyle to the pursuance of good neighborliness, peaceful coexistence, and the unity of Latin America and the Caribbean is now again seriously threatened by President Maduro's words and action on Wednesday. Reporting for The Evening News, Fanu Manikchand.
Meanwhile, the country's parliamentary opposition has also condemned Venezuela's latest actions as a flagrant violation of international law, the Geneva Agreement, and the letter and spirit of the recent joint declaration of Argyle for dialogue and peace. In this regard, the opposition has urged Venezuela to act responsibly and not further inflame the geopolitical fault lines of the region and thereby threaten its further peaceful development. Meanwhile, President Dr. Irfan Ali has reiterated Guyana's commitment to a peaceful outcome of the ongoing border controversy with its South American neighbor, Venezuela, but in the same breath, he noted that Guyana is being watchful of the developments in Caracas. The Guyanese head of state made these remarks earlier today as he delivered the feature address at the 6th Annual Security Challenges in Latin America Forum on the theme, environmental protection, land use in the Amazon Basin, and marine conservation. During a subsequent question and answer segment, President Ali was asked about Venezuela's latest attempt to annex Guyana's Essequibo region and its impact on the region. Let's have a look at his response.
We are pursuing a peaceful outcome. Guyana's objective is to ensure that this region remains stable, a region of peace. So our forest form of defense is diplomacy. We want peaceful coexistence with our neighbors. We want to ensure that no action is initiated from Guyana that can destabilize the region, that can contribute to the creation of one more problem in the world. We want to help to removing problems from the world. So, but at the same time, we are not naive. We are very careful, very watchful about everything that is happening. We believe in international law. We have called upon our neighbors to participate fully in the ICJ process and to respect the outcome of the ICJ process. But we are a country that is acutely aware of where our borders are, and we are a country that is determined to ensure that all that is contained within our borders remain within our borders and remain the assets of Guyana. We have no intention of coveting any other assets from any one of our neighbors. Our only intention is to live peacefully and to develop our country for the Guyanese people, but more importantly, ensuring that our prosperity leads to regional prosperity. Recently, we had a trilateral between Guyana, Suriname, and Brazil with President Santoki and President Lula, and we have outlined very clearly what we see this integration, how we see the integration should look like and would look like. And Venezuela must understand that they're part of a region that is working on establishing strong credentials in relation to the rule of law, democracy, respect for each other, respect for territorial integrity. And we're going to do all that we can to encourage our neighbors to be good global citizens and not to deviate from the path of what is good for the citizens of the region and the citizens of Guyana and Venezuela.
Vice President Dr. Barajag Diyo today also assured citizens that the government of Guyana remains vigilant as President of Venezuela Nicolas Maduro promulgates the organic law for the defense of Guyana Essequibo. During his weekly press conference, Jag Diyo said Guyana will not let its guards down on this matter. He noted that government has already briefed its legal team on these latest developments from Venezuela, which enacted laws on Wednesday to annex more than two-thirds of Guyana's sovereign territory, the Essequibo, a move that is a violation of the Argyle Declaration. According to the vice president, government has notified its partners on Venezuela's bad faith so that they are aware of the new developments relating to the ongoing border controversy. Here is more.
Now, clearly, this is a foreign annexation by decree, by law, although it's not physical annexation. And it runs contrary to the Argyle Agreement and to what the process that we're engaged in now before the ICJ. In fact, it runs counter to the provisional measures given by the World Court that prohibits any change of the status quo in relation to the 1899 award. And so Venezuela is seeking to unilaterally change this. We have already notified all of our partners. We have brought this to their attention. The bad faith negotiations of Venezuela. And so they are aware of what's happening. Many of them are expressing concern and also outrage about this approach, the untrustworthy nature of the regime there. And we are not going to let our guards down. So I hope that the country recognizes this. Our lawyers have been briefed. Everyone has been fully briefed on this matter.
As wildfires continue to rage in several communities across Guyana, several agencies have been mobilized to help citizens affected medically and economically. Trisha Sobers joins us now to report that between last evening and this morning, a number of residents from an Amerindian village were forced to evacuate as threat of the natural disaster intensified.
On Wednesday, raging wildfires in the communities of Santa Mission and Santa Aratak Region 3 Essequibo Islands west of Marara reached a critical point, rendering it impossible for firefighters to access the affected areas for extinguishing efforts. As a result, joint service teams shift their focus to ensuring the safety and well-being of the residents through swift evacuation measures. The dense smoke emanating from the fire has prompted the evacuation of over 20 individuals from Santa Mission and neighboring village Santa Aratak. Majority of the evacuees have found temporary shelters at the Timiri Primary School, while some are being accommodated by their relatives. During his weekly press conference, Vice President Dr. Barajag Diyo disclosed that the Health Ministry is equipped and ready to provide care to individuals battling health complications as a result of fires. These include smoke inhalation, heat stress, radiation, and air pollution. Further, the Civil Defense Commission is setting up shelters across the country and packaging food supplies for persons displaced by wildfires. While no homes or personal assets have been destroyed thus far, the Vice President explained that farming communities that depend on agriculture are among those in need of urgent assistance.
As the President pointed out, hampers for some of the communities in Region 9 that have had all their crops. And those places, people mainly deal with subsistence farming. It's not like the coastal areas where people work elsewhere. They're mainly subsistence farming. So the issue is they don't just lose income, they lose food, a source of food. And therefore, we have supplied hampers, we're sending in cassava from the coast to some of their hinterland communities.
Meanwhile, the Vice President explained that future investments garnered will strengthen Guyana's preparedness to better manage climate-related challenges.
The extreme weather that we will continue to experience, that is why we are spending so much of our resources on adaptation measures. You know that the entire sum of money that we are going to raise from the sale of forest carbon, maybe over $2 billion, US dollars, will be spent from in the country on adaptation.
Guyana has experienced over 1,300 wildfires since January, and this is a direct result of the El Nino phenomenon, which is responsible for the prolonged dry season. Joint service teams are utilizing satellite imagery surveillance to monitor fires countrywide, while land and air techniques are being used to prevent fires from escalating. Trishelle Sobers, Evening News.
Coming up, Rosignol fishermen to benefit from improved facilities following President Ali's intervention, and entrepreneurs living with disabilities secure $4 million in interest-free loans. Do stay with us. More news ahead.
Looking to bring your dream home to reality? Or simply taking on a home improvement project? Then National Hardware Limited is where you should start. Let us put that touch to your home. Choose from over 1,000 Berger Paint Original Hues for any surface. We are known for our trusted brands such as Westinghouse, Philips, Satco, Rubbermaid, Pyrex, Gibson Home, and so much more. National Hardware Limited, your do-it-best store. Located in downtown Georgetown and industrial site Rhymeville.
Guyana's landscape is set to immensely transform, with some $221.4 billion earmarked to fast-track the country's infrastructural development. To improve accessibility, $204.1 billion was budgeted for roads and bridges. Some $6.9 billion will be going towards strengthening the country's river and sea defense, $8.1 billion and $2.3 billion for improved river and air transport respectively. These projects are supported by the country's first $1 trillion budget, which was supported by oil revenues.
Premier insurance coverage for less. Stay safe.
On the job, you know how it goes. One minute, everything's going right, and the next, something goes wrong. Don't worry, Premier Insurance will make things right again. For all risks insurance, call 223-0840 or visit premierinsurance.gy. Fuel your success. Premier Insurance coverage for less.
Be my decor, stop the finest in the country. Both ceramic and porcelain. Tiles and chandeliers, you'll see. While you shop around stress free, well trained staff and warming halls make your shopping smooth and calm, providing you with quality to match your style that's so unique. Be my decor.
Welcome back. You're watching the Evening News. In light of significant investments being made to upgrade the Chedijegan International Airport, along with efforts being undertaken to facilitate ease of travel, airlines are being encouraged to make Guyana their stopover choice for long-haul flights. The call was made by Minister of Public Works Juan Egil on Tuesday night during a reception to mark the inaugural United Airlines flight between Georgetown and Houston. Michael Henry reports.
A good reminder is that the CARICOM headquarters is here in Guyana. We provide and will continue to provide a very engaging service in South America, particularly Brazil, our neighbor right next door. and we are looking at options of how Guyana, because of where it is positioned, can be the choice of stopover for long hauls into other parts of the world, cutting travel time and providing a very useful stopover as well.
Minister of Public Works Juan Edgell on Tuesday, during a reception in honor of the new air travel route established between Houston and Georgetown by United Airlines. He indicated that as Guyana continues to attract more investments in its aviation sector and witness increases in travelers within the country, the government is making the necessary investments to support the growth of the industry. The minister pointed to the legislative amendments made in 2022 to allow licensed foreigners to drive in the country without permits.
We want to make your travel experience more comfortable. We have put legislation in place to ensure that people can come here and drive. You don't have to go and apply for permits. We are putting systems in place to ensure that we have bilingual signs and directions on our streets to ensure that people need to be guided, will be guided. We are improving safety in every way, in the air and on the land. So United, keep coming, keep bringing, keep coming and going, and let the family widen. God bless you all.
The minister also referred to the significant investments being made to the Chetty-Jagan International Airport.
You're all well aware that the Chetty-Jagan International Airport has signed two memorandums of understanding, one with the Manchester Airport and one with Punta Cana Airport, because we're looking at how we could upgrade our physical infrastructure, processing services to make the travel experience a greater one. We're building out the commercial center, which is coming to completion soon. This will see an additional business launch, a VIP launch, other concession areas with restaurants, and capacity to make the travel experience much more comfortable. We're building out a special building to house airline offices. Sooner rather than later, as United expands, they will be asking for more office space to deal with their staff on ground.
Michelle Henry, The Evening News.
President Dr. Irfan Ali yesterday met with fisherfolk attached to the Rosignol Fishermen's Co-op Society and committed to providing assistance based on requests from the fishers. In this Andrew Carmichael report, we hear that the head of state has also put plans in place to address alcoholism, gambling, drug use, teenage and mental health issues which are plaguing the community.
President Dr. Irfan Ali's visit to the Rosignol fishermen on Wednesday was intended to get first-hand feedback on issues affecting them and their community, with the aim of making interventions to resolve those issues. Last week, President Ali had met with fishers at the Edward Village, and during that meeting, a request was made for him to meet with the Rosignol group of fishers. Ali told the fisher folk at Rosignol that his administration will continue to support them. Among some of the concerns raised were the need for an improved wharf, upgraded tarmac, lighting, and the need for a new fuel tank. The president was told that the co-op society is losing lots of gas every time they sell and that the pump was in a bad state. The officials also asked for the building that housed the office to be upgraded and the compound fence to be upgraded. They also highlighted that boats and equipment are worth millions, but those assets are not being recognized by the banks as collateral.
Which means if we go to the bank for that, we go to the bank and care if we can't care that the bank can pass again extra money for it to develop or whatever. We got the bank nagging nothing to fishermen. The money is not valid, the boat is not valid to the bank. That's the only challenge we face. Well, we throw the same to pine, here to pine. Sometimes the wind take it from another direction to carry it to another direction. We lost a lot of scene and stuff. So that is challenging. When we lost the scene, we not get back the capital for return back to the investment. So the investment we go back to, we go back to somebody who can take it. The buyers are who buy this fish. The fishermen them go to them for the money to buy back this kind of scene. Now these kind of people, when you buy back the scene from them, They're talking about 50%, maybe paying 50% more the same money.
Those investors, the head of state was told, would lend the fishers money at an interest rate of 50%. Fishers also called on the president to include another category of boat engines being used in the fishing industry in the duty-free list for the fishing industry. Currently, boat engines that are used in the fishing industry and below 75 horsepower can be acquired duty-free. The president promised to look into having four-stroke engines included in the duty-free list for the fishing industry. Meanwhile, President Ali said his government will undertake to complete the wharf which the co-op has been trying to build.
We can finish the wharf, we can do the ramp, we can look at the four-stroke engine to get that to the free for the we'll look at the fuel tank, and then we look at the washroom facility and a storeram, the storerooms and
storeroom,
a new storeroom. In addition to that, ministers will still be working with fisher folk themselves, about 300, and we want to integrate y'all into the swamp swim project in Region 5, so you can bolster your income and support your income. In addition to that, I'm going to ask Minister Ashley Singh to bring the banks here next week. Y'all listen to me?
Yes, sir.
And what I want, Zulfi, is for fisher folk all across the region to be invited to meet with Minister Ashley Singh and the banking sector, so we can get the bank to work with you in small loans.
Meanwhile, President Ali said he was not there only to assist the fishing community, but also to deal with issues plaguing the community. Alcoholism, gambling and drug abuse were at the forefront. Teenage and mental health issues, he said, will also be addressed. Andrew Carmichael, The Evening News.
The hand pump well within the village of Fort Island on the Essequibo River Region 3 will be upgraded to a photovoltaic system. Works which will commence in the coming weeks to upgrade a manually operated water well will benefit some 120 residents who are feeling the brunt of the extended dry season. Trishelle Sobers reports.
Like some other communities, residents of Fort Island heavily rely on the river for water, a hand pump well, and rainwater harvesting. After a thorough assessment of the old system, the engineers attached to the Guyana Watching Cooperative suggested that a photovoltaic system be installed, given that this solution proved to be the best alternative for the short term. The scope of works for the current shallow well includes the installation of 2 inches submersible pump complete with well master, control switch, solar panels, low float, overhead storage, and a short distribution system. Housing and Water Minister Colin Kroll explained that a long-term solution will be implemented, hinting that his ministry will be exploring the drilling of a new well to better serve the community.
This year, we are on a massive budgetary program to ensure we are able to do exactly that. Two ways. One, the first-time access, and secondly, for those on the coast or those who may fall within the Perica going onwards, to ensure that they are able to have treated water. Now more than ever across our country, all communities are feeling the brunt, and all our people are understanding when we go wrong with GWI's motto that says water is life, what it really means.
Residents were also encouraged to assist with the installation of the distribution network, as standpipes will be erected into the community.
Now that we're doing that, we are looking for a little community participation though. If you have persons who can assist, because the pipes are here, and the pipes are not here for the well, the pipes are here for us to put down in this small community a distribution network, and we will be putting down a number of standpipes, so that you can all have access to potable water.
This initiative, the minister said, is a testament to the administration's commitment to ensuring equal access to basic services. Trishelle Sobers, Evening News.
In yet another groundbreaking stride towards financial autonomy, a group of persons living with permanent disabilities recently accessed $4 million in interest-free loans to expand their entrepreneurial pursuits. Michelle Henry tells us more.
facilitated by the Human Services and Social Security Ministry and Small Business Borrow Revolving Fund, 8 recipients received $500,000 each, providing a vital support to individuals who have often encountered significant hurdles in securing financial banking for their business ventures. The loans are provided with no collateral requirement and zero interest rates. Among the recipients is Mohammed Shamir from Grove on the East Bank of Demerara, a visually impaired entrepreneur who has been facing challenges with his business.
It's a very hard challenge for me right now due to the fact that the distribution companies, the distribution vans and them, don't pay visits to the small shops and them because they only go to the big Chinese stores and supply them with everything such like every snack that I want to get, only I'm not getting them. It's hard for me and it's very difficult because of my disability, having to take taxis and go to the black market to shops to buy back, to sell back. We can't cope with the Chinese, so it's very, very challenging.
Meanwhile, Odessa Evans from Annadale East Coast Demerara, who has a poultry business and has a speech impediment and a nervous condition, had long dreamed of expanding her business.
I do enjoy taking care of the chick. I have a strong passion towards my business and my dream is to go far in my business, expand my business and bring more products for my community and other community in Guyana around me.
For Asif Khan, who lives with a visual impairment, the loan represents more than just financial assistance. It symbolizes a belief in his potential as a businessman.
Yeah, so it's Khan's Electronics and Computer Supplies, and the main purpose of it is to, or the main activity is, you know, everything computer-based, electronics, computer accessories, stuff like that, everything electronic.
Okay, and how will this loan help you?
Well, one of the problems, you know, most small businesses have is access to capital, and definitely with the loan, you know, it gives you that independence, it gives you that opportunity to have capital to set up your business and, you know, to grow and expand.
The other beneficiaries were Andrea Hendricks, Lennox Bob Semple, Roberta English, and Lawrence Brathwith. At the handing over event, Minister of Human Services and Social Security, Dr. Vindhya Prasad, expressed that this initiative is just another in a long list of investments and interventions being made by the government to support persons living with disabilities. Meanwhile, Minister of Commerce, Oneej Warren, emphasized the importance of inclusivity within the business sector, assuring that programs benefiting individuals with disabilities will continue to be developed and implemented by the government. Michelle Henry, The Evening News.
The construction of the first 100 young professional homes has commenced at Silica City as part of the area's first phase development. Silica City, situated along the Soustdyke-Linden Highway, will be Guyana's first smart urban center and is the brainchild of President Dr. Irfan Ali. The young professional homes will be constructed in four distinct styles, comprising two flat units valued at $25,200,603 and $25,291,78, and two elevated units priced at $33,980,153 and $34,450,145. Each flat home boasts a master bedroom with closet and washroom, two other bedrooms, washroom, kitchen, dining area, living room and laundry room. The two-story elevated homes feature a master bedroom with closet and washroom, two other bedrooms, an additional room, washrooms, kitchen, dining area, living room and sitting room. Infrastructure works such as road and drainage networks are also ongoing. The development is being monitored by the Central Housing and Planning Authority's Projects Department. And now for a look at the bridge reports.
The Demerara Harbour Bridge will be closed to vehicular traffic on Friday, April 5, 2024 at 1:30 for 1.5 hours. Meanwhile, the Berbi Sufer Bridge is expected to be closed at 13:55 on Friday, April 5, 2024, also for 1.5 hours.
Bring Anyone, says Ali Cock ahead of professional debut, and Guyana Under 15s finished second after victory over Leewards. Details of these stories coming up in the Sportcast, sponsored by MACorp.
Looking to bring your dream home to reality? Or simply taking on a home improvement project? Then National Hardware Limited is where you should start. Let us put that touch to your home. Choose from over 1,000 Berger Paint Original Hues for any surface. We are known for our trusted brands such as Westinghouse, Philips, Sadco, Rubbermaid, Pyrex, Gibson Home, and so much more. National Hardware Limited, your do-it-best store. Located in downtown Georgetown and industrial site Rhymeville.
Heavy duty equipment, owners and mechanics. Transfer and dispense grease easily, quickly and precisely. From 110 to 132 pound drums with a roughneck air operated mobile grease pump kit from Sylvie's. This durable product saves maintenance time, is designed to be portable and keeps impurities out of your grease drum. Shop now at sylviesonline.com or visit our 31 High and Hatfield Street store. We also deliver. Call or WhatsApp 623-7755 for more info.
Did you know that Gassy's Jet A1 fuel is a type of aviation fuel specially formulated for turbine engines? Jet A1 fuel is safer to handle and transport than any other fuel types due to its high flash point and low volatility. It also boasts a high energy content, enhancing aircraft performance and efficiency. So whether traveling for business or pleasure, choose Gayo's Jet A1 fuel for a safe, reliable, and efficient flight.
Not a single bar of service.
Not with us. Digicel officially has the best mobile coverage in Guyana. Ookla, the company behind Speedtest, recognizes Digicel as the network with the best mobile coverage in Guyana. Be it in Aishalton or in Etiringbang, we got you covered.
Digicel, the award-winning network for everyone, everywhere.